Good evening and welcome into this service of worship. I was singing along as Julie was playing, "You Alone Are My Heart's Desire." So beautiful. I love the melody. But I have to confess that the words are challenging. And to be able to sing, "You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you." Psalm 73, the psalmist says, "Whom am I in heaven but you, and earth has nothing that I desire but you." And I think about those words from time to time. You alone are my heart's desire, and you alone, and earth has nothing that I desire but you. And I confess I'm not there yet, but we're getting closer. We're all under construction. And by the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, more and more, the things of earth grow strangely dim. More and more, earth has nothing that I desire but you. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, whom have we in heaven but you? And more, earth has nothing that we desire but you. Lord, we pray that we'd be able to sing with our hearts that you alone are our heart's desire. That's why we're here tonight, because we long to worship you. Lord, you're worthy. You're worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our worship. And we come here tonight and saying thanks. Thanks for this opportunity. Thanks for giving us reason to be here. That you've called us by name, put faith in our hearts. You've given us a Savior to save us from our sins, to clothe us in perfect righteousness, so that when we stand before you someday, it'll be faultless. We'll be faultless before your throne, dressed in Christ's righteousness alone. Oh, Lord, we pray that you will move our hearts here tonight by the power of your Spirit, so that the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts please you and are acceptable to you, that you be glorified. And Father, we are bold to ask that we be blessed as well, that our hearts, our minds be edified, that we leave this place aglow with your presence, because yet again we have met with you. Lord, we entrust this time to you and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand for the call to worship. These are familiar words from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 40. "To whom will you compare me, or who is my equal?" says the Holy One. "Lift your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls them each by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of this is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and complain, O Israel, that my way is hidden from the Lord? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's do some singing together. "Instruments of your peace, and I love to tell the story."
Thank you.
confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I need thee every hour. It's interesting how you can sing a hymn like I Need Thee Every Hour. Probably in my lifetime have sung that hymn maybe a couple hundred times. Who knows? I don't know. But then certain phrases kind of strike you, well, at least me. And a phrase that we just sang that struck me that really, quite frankly, you know how you sing sometimes, but really don't think about the words. A phrase struck me. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh. It kind of struck me anew again tonight and was encouraged by that. Temptations lose, because temptations are strong, but temptations lose their power, Lord, when you're near, when thou art nigh. I like that. Concerns and praises before we go to God in prayer. Julie. Yeah. Praise. What's the last line?
I said it was big news.
Yeah, I didn't either. And a lot of times you just don't think these things are going to happen. And yet here again, wow, to that big news in terms of the court decision, the overturning of Roe versus Wade. And God does answer prayers. He does. And what an amazing thing. But by the reaction in the country, and I was jotted an email out this morning to the Martin Reform folks about this ever so briefly, but just by the reaction, it still tells us, wow, there's a lot of minds and hearts and souls still to be won over in this country. A lot of work ahead of us as a church, but I celebrate with you. Yeah. Let's pray together. Oh, yeah. The Weir family? Meir. Yeah, I don't know the word, but someone has cancer or... Okay, Joanne Meir. Okay, ovarian cancer. We'll pray for Joanne. Okay. That's scary. And I see in your bulletin that you're sending a letter of intent for a call. We'll pray for that too. Let's pray. Oh, did you? Oh, I'm sorry. What's the number? Which 67? Okay, 67th birthday. All right, wonderful. Okay. Let's join together in prayer. Father in heaven, praise be to you. Lord, you've redeemed us from the pit, crowned us with grace and loving kindness. You've saved us from our sins by giving us a Savior, one who bore the penalty we deserve, so that your justice is satisfied. And one who lived a perfect life, your son, Jesus, our Savior. A perfect life in whose righteousness has been given to us. Lord, thanks. And Father, we praise you for everyday life, for the good things in this world, for plenty of food that we have, that our daily bread, I know I've never been in lack for it. And Lord, for providing for our needs, shelter, and more than that, beyond food and clothing and shelter, you give us comforts and even luxuries. And Lord, we are thankful. We don't know why we're so blessed to be born in this country, live in this land, whereas others aren't. But Lord, one thing we are is thankful. We express our gratitude to you for all the blessings and the enjoyments of life in this world. And then again, oh Lord, we thank you for eternal life, because we know that the enjoyments of the present wouldn't be there if in the end we knew there was defeat and condemnation. But precisely because we know the victory has been won, and there's an inheritance waiting for us that'll never perish, spoil, or fade. Lord, because of this, it gives us hope for today and gets us through life. And we thank you. Father, we praise you for the overturning of a court decision many years ago, back in 1973, that we know as Roe v. Wade, a decision that opened the door up in this country to the killing of so many babies. Not to be stopped in any state, but all across the land. And, oh Lord, we thank you and praise you that that horrible decision of 73 has been reversed. And we pray that this will lead to the saving of many unborn lives. And Lord, we know too that there are still many in this country whose eyes are not open to see that these little ones unborn are truly little ones created in your image. And so we pray that we as a church, that you will use us as your church to spread truth, to spread the good news, to spread the teachings of Scripture. And we pray, O Lord, that many will come to know you, and that this country not be on a path of godlessness, but be restored to a path of godliness. And I say restored, I know we've never been a perfect nation, but Lord, that more are following you again. You tell us that righteousness exalts a nation. You tell us in your word that blessed is the nation whose God is you. And so, Lord, we pray that we become a more and more righteous nation, that we be more greatly exalted by you and blessed. Father, we pray for Joanne Meir as this diagnosis of cancer has been given. And oh Lord, we know that nothing's too hard for you to conquer, to defeat. And so we lift Joanne up to you and pray that you will beat this cancer back. Even though it's further along than we want it to be, but that you will bring your mighty hand of healing to bear and bring restoration, heal. Father, we pray for your mighty power to restore Joanne completely. And Father, for the 67th birthday celebrated, we give you praise. And we thank you for every year of life you give us. Lord, we thank you for every day of life you give us. We realize that it's always a gift, and we can never take it for granted. That even as it says somewhere in the book of Job, one of those so-called friends of Job, though they got so much wrong in terms of applying truth to Job and not to themselves, Lord, some things they said so well, and one of them was that if you would remove your hand from us, we would again become as the dust of the earth. And so we thank you for your sustaining power for yet another year. And again, O Lord, for every day you give us. And then, Lord, we We praise you that the search committee has approved Pastor Dirk Kutcha as a prospective pastor to receive a call. And Lord, we pray for this process, and we pray for your leading in this. And Father, we ask that you will make your will abundantly clear to him. And Lord, you know our heart's desire. We're at this point of giving a call to the pastor. And our desire, O Lord, is that he takes, accepts. And so, Lord, we, in some ways, that's what we pray. You ask us to lay before you our heart's desires, and our heart's desires is that you bring a pastor to this congregation, this church family. And the Lord, as the committee has chosen Pastor Kutcha, we pray that pastor-congregation relationship be consummated here. But most of all, we pray for your wisdom and your guidance, that you will, again, we ask that you will make your will abundantly clear to Pastor Dirk. Father, thanks again for this time here tonight. What a blessing to be here with fellow believers, to be standing in your presence, worshiping you. We love you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and we pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our offering will be for Mel Trotter Ministries. Our scripture lesson tonight is taken from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 15, verses 11 through 32. It is a very familiar text to many Christians. There are two probably very famous parables, that of the prodigal son and that of the good Samaritan, that are found only in Luke. You won't find them in Matthew or Mark or John, but those two, you find only in Luke. And we're going to look tonight at what is often called the parable of the prodigal son. It's a little intimidating because I mentioned a little bit ago that I have probably sung a hymn a couple hundred times. I'm guessing every pastor you've ever had has preached from this particular text. And I'm not sure if it can add anything new. And yet it's a great lesson, or an important lesson here in this particular parable. And so we're going to look at it yet again tonight. Luke 15, verses 11 through 32. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he spent everything, and there was severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. And so he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his field to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have food to spare, and here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven, against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' And so he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And so they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. And when he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. 'Your brother has come,' he replied, 'and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has him back safe and sound.' And the older brother became angry, refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. You never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him.' 'My son,' the father said, 'you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' This is the word of the Lord." Before we move on to the proclamation, let's pray. Father, we've read your word and we thank you for it. And now as we move on to its proclamation, we pray that you will send your spirit to fill the weakness of human words with great power. Use them to open up our eyes again to see truth and draw us closer to you, in Jesus' name. Amen. Most people call the story that we just read the parable of the prodigal son. And very often the lesson that we draw from it is that we Christians should not be like this bad son. Or at least not the first part. And the last part, yes. You know, the repentance and coming back, yes. But the first part, no. And so we say, look at what happens to those people who spend their lives living recklessly and wildly. Eventually, they end up being miserable and they are forced to admit that a wholesome and a godly life is far better. This has been a very common lesson that a lot of Christians take home from this parable. And of course, we have to admit that that is a very important lesson. It's very true that immoral living brings trouble and that godly living brings contentment. And yet, this isn't the point of the parable. In fact, the primary lesson of this story isn't about the prodigal son at all. Instead, it is all about the waiting father and his willingness to forgive even the greatest of sinners. You see, what Jesus wants us to do after hearing this story is examine our own lives and discover what our attitude is toward those who we think are less holy than ourselves. Do we receive them when they come to us? And do we rejoice when they turn to God like the prodigal son's father? Or do we mutter and groan like the older son who, because he thought he was more righteous, begrudged the mercy shown to his younger brother? The whole point of this parable is to be like the waiting father, who is like our Father in heaven. That this is the meaning of the parable becomes clear if we would take time. We didn't, but we'll take a little bit of time now. If we took the time to look at all of Luke 15, there are three parables here, all with something lost and something found. And the chapter begins with a group of tax collectors and so-called sinners gathered around Jesus. That's how Luke 15 starts. For Jesus being with these obviously sinful people was a normal occurrence, but for the Pharisees, it was cause for alarm. They said to each other, looking at Jesus, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." You see, the Pharisees considered themselves too good for this sort of thing. In fact, they even wrote a little law about it. It said, the law said, "You shall not have as a guest or be the guest of any man who has a public record of sin." Wow, you wouldn't be able to eat with anyone, you'd think. Pharisees were even forbidden, so far as possible, to do any business with such people. When they walked on the streets, they tried real hard to avoid people who did not observe the petty details of the law. And perhaps worst of all, instead of hoping that these sinners and tax collectors would someday repent of their sins and come to know the truth so that they could rejoice with them, instead they didn't seem to care much about their eternity. It was this self-righteous and hypocritical attitude that Jesus wanted to penetrate. And so he told the Pharisees three parables, which reveal that while they, the Pharisees, may not care for the lost, God does. The first parable is about a man who had 100 sheep. When one got lost, he left the others behind to go out and search for the lost one. And when he found it, he called his neighbors together for a party, saying, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." Now, the point of the parable is not the sheep. The point of the parable is not how naughty that lost sheep was and how we should not wander off like the lost sheep. No. The point of the parable is the searching shepherd. Jesus is teaching that God is like the shepherd. He yearns for the lost as opposed to the Pharisees who wanted nothing to do with the lost, who kept themselves away from the lost. And then when the lost is found in this first parable, there's rejoicing in heaven. The message of Jesus' second parable is the same. A woman has 10 silver coins but loses one. And so she diligently searches all through the house until she finds it. And when she does find it, she, like the shepherd, calls her neighbors together for a party, saying, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." Again, the point of the parable is not the lost coin, but the searching woman. Jesus is teaching that God is like the woman. He doesn't give up on the lost like the Pharisees. He wants the wayward to be found. And not only does he desire it, he does something about it. He searches them out, like the shepherd looking for a single lost sheep, like the woman who would not rest until her lost coin was found. And then when God does find the lost, like the shepherd and woman, he rejoices and calls others to rejoice with him. And then finally, Jesus tells this third parable. By now, we have figured out that the focus is not on that which is lost. Rather, the point is the one who longed to find. In this case, the waiting father. Through this parable, Jesus is not trying to depict how bad the younger son was, even though he was bad. Rather, the point is how wonderful God is. Many of us know the story. The father has two sons. The younger one decides he wants his inheritance while the father is still alive. The father gives it to him. Now, at this point, some will quibble as to whether or not the father should have given him the inheritance. But that's not the issue here. In fact, that the father did give the inheritance is very much how God deals with us, isn't it? He gives us more than we deserve. He gives us riches of which we are far from worthy, like the prodigal son. Sometimes God gives us the freedom that the younger son wanted, and the result is that we wander out on our own. Perhaps some of us have done some of this wandering. We say to God, or said at some point in our lives to God, Lord, just give me what I think is mine and let me go. That was the younger son, and his father let him go. And for a while, the son most likely thought that he had made a good decision. Life was good. Pleasure was abundant. For a while, the fun lasted. But then the prodigal found out that human worldly pleasure tends to run out. Since money was the foundation of his life, after his money was gone, his whole life fell apart. In desperation, he took a job feeding pigs for a Jew. This, think about it, this had to be the worst of the worst. Pigs were unclean animals, and as such, Jews couldn't even touch pigs without becoming unclean. Living among them and caring for them was probably 100 times worse. It was the pinnacle of shame. We would call it hitting rock bottom. But it was on that bottom that the younger son was forced to look up and finally realize that his father's house wasn't so bad after all. It was still the best place to be. And so with a repentant heart, he returned home. Now, the son's arrival home caused two very opposite reactions. On the one hand, the father who was waiting at the roadside rejoiced because at long last his lost son, whom he loved so much, had returned home. As with the shepherd finding the lost sheep, as with a woman finding the lost coin, the return of the lost son meant it was time for a party. For a great deal of rejoicing. Jesus is saying, God is like the waiting father. He longs for the return of his lost children, and when they do return, he and the angels in heaven rejoice. Furthermore, Jesus was saying to the Pharisees, you see me doing the same thing. You see me with tax collectors and sinners, and the reason why is because I'm like the waiting father. This is what I am like. I am associating with these sinners because I long for them to see that their lives are being lived among pigs. I'm here because I long for them to realize that there is a better way to live. With a heavenly father who is waiting to put a ring on their fingers and give them a feast. But now, just in case the Pharisees didn't get it, just in case they missed the message of the lost sheep and the lost coin, the lost son, Jesus continued his little parable with the older son's reaction. The older son wasn't like the father at all. He reacted with disgust toward his younger brother. He felt ripped off. That's what we would say. You see, he was like the Pharisees. He didn't rejoice with the angels in heaven. He didn't rejoice at all. He wanted nothing to do with this evil brother of his. He objected to all of the celebrations. He didn't understand all of this partying for this bad kid. He didn't care about the lost being found. He didn't care about the lost period. For the older son, there wasn't room for grace. He only thought in terms of categories and categories of law. Punish the wanderer, reward the one staying home. Now, of course, we can understand the older son's feeling. Every time I read this parable, I get it. I get how he feels. You never killed a fatted calf for me. In fact, I dare say that a lot of Christians relate more to the older son than to the younger. And the reason for this is because for many Christians who've been raised in church all their lives, I'm one of them. For many Christians, their weakness is not the temptation toward making life one big wild party. No. For many lifelong Christians, the bigger temptation is that of self-righteousness. Like the Pharisees and the older brother, sometimes we fall into the sinful trap of thinking ourselves better than the younger brother types. Lord, thank you that I'm not like him. Sometimes we think that we are more worthy of the fattened calf than those sinners over there. And we let this attitude at times be known by the way we act toward so-called villains of the world. We avoid them like the Pharisees. And even when some of them do turn back to God, it's so easy to begrudge God's generosity with them. Jesus, however, shows us a better way. He shows us the way of the waiting father. By the way, there's a theologian by the name of Helmut Tillich who changed in, this is what he called this parable. Didn't call it the parable of the prodigal son, but called it the parable of the waiting father. And I get that. It's a good, I think, probably a better designation. Jesus shows us a better way. That of the waiting father, he shows us the way of the heavenly father. Not only does the heavenly father wait, he sits at the edge of the road and longs for his family to finally come back to him. But not only does he sit and long, he diligently searches them out as those first two parables teach. He cares about even the one lost sheep when he's got 99 in the fold. He doesn't say, well, hey, 99%, that's a good rate. No. When one is lost, he goes out and looks. And when it's found, he rejoices. What a great truth to celebrate. What a great God we have. The Pharisees needed to hear it again, and so do we. Jesus calls us simply to love people, love the lost, long for them like God does, like the waiting father. Don't be like the older son. He had forgotten of what his father had to remind him of. Son, he said, realize that everything I have is yours. That's us. We have an inheritance waiting. You're no less poor, son, when one of these lost ones comes home. It's important for us to realize. Sometimes it's easy, and I get the same thing when I read the parable of when Jesus hires somebody in the first hour, or when the landowner hires somebody in the first hour, and then the second hour, and third hour, and the end of the day he hires, and he gives them all the same wage, and you think, well, that's not very fair. But what we're doing is begrudging the generosity of the landowner, the grace that God gives. And what we need to realize is that we don't become any poorer when God is more generous with others. There's no need to be like the Pharisees or the older son. God's riches do not become any less when they are shared. In the human scheme of things, of course they do. If your parents start adding all of their friends in their will, the kids are going to start saying, well, hey, mom, hey, dad, wait a minute. You know, you're adding all your friends in the will. That's going to mean less for us, for me. But in heaven, our inheritance isn't any less if God adds another person to his family. Instead, it grows. The Pharisees and the older brother needed to learn this. You see, they were in the same boat. They didn't understand God and his grace. They thought the Father's love was something you earn by tending the farm. They thought that showing love to sinners is a bad thing. They cared little for the lost because, well, the lost don't deserve it. But in their eyes, they did deserve it. And so Jesus gives us this parable, and the lessons are clear. Don't be like the older son. Don't be jealous of God's generosity toward others. Realize that what we have because we're on God's farm. Older son types need to see that their plates are full, not empty, not lacking. Older son types need to see that their plates remain full even when God is generous with that prodigal younger brother. To the older son, the father said, everything I have is yours. By the same token, don't be like the younger son either early on. You'll find yourself chasing after the world, but only catching misery. To the younger son types, God says, come home. To the older son types, everything I have is yours. To the younger son types, God says, come home. Come home unto me, all you who are tired and weary, and I will give you rest. Here you are wallowing in the struggles of your sin. Look up. Look beyond the pigsty. Look up and see that there are riches in God's house waiting for you. Your heavenly Father is longing for you to come home. Therefore, rise up, younger son types, out of the mud. Swallow your pride like the younger son had to do. Make your way home to God. He's standing at the side of the road waiting for you, longing to put a ring on your finger and start the feast. Here then really is the point of the whole parable. Be like the waiting father. That's how Jesus lived. Befriend sinners, love sinners. Jesus told us this parable so that we, like him, throw open the doors of our hearts to those who are in need, and then to join the feast when the lost are found. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word and this parable. Lord, we know that the world is filled with older son types and younger son types. And oh Lord, we pray that the word go out to the older son types that everything we have, you have, oh Lord, is ours. The inheritance is ours. We're no less poor when you add people in the will. No, Lord, to those younger son types, the invitation to come home. Father, thank you for this parable. Meant for the Pharisees, but so applicable to all of us today as well. Lord, send us forth from this place now. Transform just a little more in your glorious image. In Jesus' name, amen. We sing together, stand as we sing together, facing a task unfinished. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.
Father who sustains